Glenn Beck.
Truly, there is nothing that I love better than hearing a woman responsible for the worst Syrian policy on planet Earth, a woman responsible for lying repeatedly to the American people about events in Benghazi, a woman responsible for a foreign policy that elevated Iran at the expense of American allies, jabber on about how President Trump is undermining American values in terms of his foreign policy. Susan Rice is back. Yes, it is amazing. Ben Rhodes, who is just an execrable human being. Ben Rhodes, the former national security advisor, whose vast foreign policy expertise before joining the administration resided entirely in writing fiction stories from an apartment in Brooklyn. That guy was tweeting out about how the Republicans, their obituaries should have a picture of them standing next to President Trump because Trump is so terrible. Well, their obituaries should have a picture. If Ben Rhodes has an obituary, you know, he should live long. When his obituary is finally written, there should just be a picture of an Iranian missile on it. Because the fact is that the Obama administration not only emboldened Iran, but made Iran a regional power. And Susan Rice was part of that. Now she has a piece in the New York Times on their op-ed page, which is the centralizing point for at least 72.3% of all human stupidity. Susan Rice has this piece. Here's what she writes. Okay, it is titled, I'm not joking, When America No Longer Is a Global Force for Good. You know, ignoring the whole part where the Obama administration backed Iran and backed the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt and backed the Palestinian Authority against the Jews and did nothing about the slaughter in Sudan and did nothing about the slaughter of Christians across the Middle East. Now, they're the ones who are going to lecture us about when American foreign policy is not a force for good. So Susan Rice says, President Trump's national security strategy marks a dramatic departure from the plans of his Republican and Democratic predecessors, painting a dark, almost dystopian portrait of an extraordinarily dangerous world characterized by hostile states and lurking threats. That's not dystopian. That's reality. And there are a lot of hostile states and a lot of lurking threats. She says there is scant mention of America's unrivaled political, military, technological, and economical strength, or the opportunities to expand prosperity, freedom, and security through principled leadership. Okay, I would just like to note at this point, I think it's worthwhile noting, that President Obama is the one who insisted that we cut literally trillions of dollars from the defense budget in order so that we wouldn't raise taxes. That was the sequestration deal. That was President Obama's deal. Trotting out Susan Rice and Ben Rhodes as the moral leaders of the Obama administration demonstrates how hollow everything was. And this may be the area in which Trump has been the strongest. Yeah, ISIS has basically been defeated. Its territorial holdings are down to nothing. ISIS only grew because of the cowardice of the Obama administration. They only grew because Obama decided to pull out of Iraq. And Susan Rice was there for all of this stuff. And now she's lecturing the Trump administration. She's lecturing Republicans, conservatives on how foreign policy should be conducted. Absurd. I'll show you how absurd in just a second, because it gets even more absurd than that. Really. Ben Shapiro in for Glenn Beck. Well, Nikki Haley doing serious damage over at the UN General Assembly right now. That wretched hive of scum and villainy. Ben Shapiro in for Glenn Beck here on the Glenn Beck program. Right now, as we speak, Nikki Haley speaking to the UN General Assembly, which is considering whether to vote on a resolution condemning the United States for moving its embassy to Jerusalem in Israel and condemning Israel for existing, of course. And she just said, quote, the decision does nothing to harm peace efforts. Rather, the president's decision reflects the will of the American people and our right as a nation to choose the location of our embassy. There's no need to describe it further. Thank you, Nikki Haley. She's awesome. And one of the best moves of the president, making Nikki Haley his UN ambassador. She has been stalwart, to say the least. Now, on foreign policy, what we've been hearing for a year and a half is that the Trump-Russia connection is eventually going to amount to collusion, right? That eventually we are going to find out that the Trump campaign colluded with Vladimir Putin, came up with a strategy, an evil, nefarious plot to win Trump the presidency. And we know that Putin was warm toward Trump, and we know that Trump was warm toward Putin. They like each other. That is not a great thing, because Vladimir Putin is one of the worst people on planet Earth. But this has been wildly blown out of proportion to suggest that Trump is somehow in Putin's pocket, that Trump somehow finagled it so that Putin would skew the election toward him. Somehow Putin would convince Hillary Clinton never to visit Wisconsin or Michigan. And this has been the Democratic line for well over a year at this point. But when it comes to collusion, it seems like there's a lot more evidence that the Obama administration colluded with Russia than that the Trump administration did. Like, a lot more evidence. Okay, so first, some contrary evidence to the idea that Trump is colluding with Russia. So yesterday, this piece of news breaks. The Trump administration on Wednesday approved the sale of lethal arms to Ukraine's government as the country battles pro-Russian separatists in its eastern provinces. The Washington Post reported Wednesday the administration approved the sale of model M107A1 sniper systems and associated equipment to the country at a value of $41.5 million. The administration has not moved to approve heavier arms requested by Ukraine's government, but the move from the White House is a departure from the Obama administration, which frequently condemned Russian aggression in the Ukraine, but refused to approve the sale of arms to the country's Western-aligned government. So that raises a weird question. Why, oh why, did the Obama administration not do what Trump just did and allow sales of weapons, lethal weapons, to the Ukrainians? If Trump is such a tool of the Russians, why did he just do that? If Trump is such a tool of the Russians, why has he basically opposed them in many ways in Syria? If Trump is such a tool of the Russians, then why is he doing what he's doing right now against Iran? In fact, the evidence seems to be pretty substantial that if anyone was colluding with Russia, it was President Obama, who back in 2012, you will recall, was caught on a hot microphone saying directly to the then president of Russia, Dmitry Medvedev, that he should inform Vlad that to back off before the election, because after the election, Obama would have some flexibility. There's a shocking story that has received almost zero mainstream media attention. The story is in Politico. But if this had been about Trump, is there any doubt that this would have been leading the newspapers for weeks? Not for days, for weeks, maybe months. Okay, here is the story, according to Politico Europe. Okay, this is Politico Europe. Basically, it's called The Secret. It's by Josh Meyer. It's the secret backstory of how Obama let Hezbollah off the hook. Now, Ben Rhodes, as we say, the execrable former national security advisor for the Obama administration, a guy who made his name writing bad fiction from an apartment in Brooklyn. Now, that guy says that Politico has an institutional bias against the Obama administration, to which I say, ha, 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 ha. Really? You have to be on LSD to believe that. In any case, here's what the article says. Quote, in its determination to secure a nuclear deal with Iran, the Obama administration derailed an ambitious law enforcement campaign targeting drug trafficking by the Iranian-backed terrorist group Hezbollah, even as it was funneling cocaine into the United States, according to a Politico investigation. The campaign, dubbed Project Cassandra, was launched in 2008 after the DEA amassed evidence that Hezbollah had transformed itself from a Middle East-focused military and political organization into an international crime syndicate that some investigators believed was collecting $1 billion a year from drug and weapons trafficking, money laundering, and other criminal activities. Over the next 8 years, agents working out of a top-secret DEA facility in Chantilly, Virginia, used wiretaps, undercover ops, informants, to map Hezbollah's illicit networks with the help of 30 U.S. and foreign security agencies. They followed cocaine shipments, some from Latin America to West Africa and onto Europe and the Middle East, others through Venezuela and Mexico to the United States. They tracked the river of dirty cash. But as Project Cassandra reached higher into the hierarchy of the conspiracy, Obama administration officials threw an increasingly insurmountable series of roadblocks in its way. According to interviews with dozens of participants who in many cases spoke for the first time about events shrouded in secrecy. When Project Cassandra leaders sought approval for some significant investigation, prosecutions, arrests, and financial sanctions, officials at Justice and the Treasury Department delayed, hindered, or rejected their requests. The Justice Department declined requests by Project Cassandra and other authorities to file criminal charges against major players such as Hezbollah's high-profile envoy to Iran, a Lebanese bank that allegedly laundered billions in alleged drug profits, and a central player in U.S.-based cell of the Iranian paramilitary Quds Force. And the State Department rejected requests to lure high-value targets to countries where they could be arrested. In other words, as David Asher says, the guy who helped establish this Project Cassandra as a Defense Department finance analyst, quote, this was a policy decision. It was a systematic decision. They serially ripped apart this entire effort that was very well supported and resourced, and it was done from the top down. Why? Because Obama wanted his Iran deal. He wanted that deal that supposedly stopped the Iranian nuclear program but did no such thing, that merely greenlit the Iranian nuclear program a decade from inception, and ensured that Iran would become a regional power through conventional weaponry and terrorism. Okay, and not only that, they colluded with the Russians to make this happen. They colluded with the Russians to make this happen. It is amazing stuff. Okay, in practice, this is again Politico, it's not me, Politico, a left-wing source. In practice, the administration's willingness to envision a new role for Hezbollah in the Middle East combined with Hezbollah's a terrorist group, by the way, folks. Hezbollah is an evil terrorist group that fires missiles into northern Israel on a routine basis and has turned what was once a flower of the Middle East, Lebanon and Beirut, has turned it into an absolute hellhole. Lebanon is not a place you want to be hanging out or visiting. In practice, the administration's willingness to envision a new role for Hezbollah in the Middle East, combined with its desire for a negotiated settlement to Iran's nuclear program, translated into a reluctance to move aggressively against top Hezbollah operatives. And here's the collusion with Russia. You ready? Here we go. Lebanese arms dealer Ali Fayyad, a suspected top Hezbollah operative whom agents believed reported to Russian President Vladimir Putin as a key supplier of weapons to Syria and Iraq, was arrested in Prague in the spring of 2014. Good news, he's arrested, right? They can now extradite him. But for nearly 2 years, Fayyad was in custody. Top Obama administration officials declined to apply serious pressure on the Czech government to extradite him to the United States, even as Putin was lobbying aggressively against it. Fayyad, who'd been indicted in the U.S. on counts of charges of planning the murders of U.S. government employees, this guy's a murderer, attempting to provide material support to a terrorist organization, attempting to acquire, transfer, use anti-aircraft missiles, was ultimately sent back to Lebanon. He is now believed by U.S. officials to be back in business, helping to arm militants in Syria and elsewhere with Russian heavy weapons. It sounds a lot like collusion. It sounds a lot like the Trump, like the Obama administration working with the Russians on behalf of a terrorist group, Hezbollah, also that Trump, so that Obama, rather, could pursue his evil, despicable Iran deal, all of which he thought would redound to his benefit politically. That's collusion, folks. That's collusion. Not the nonsense that's being thrown up there as collusion. Again, all of the charges that I've seen so far in the Mueller investigation have been about people lying to the FBI. You shouldn't lie to the FBI. Lying to the FBI is bad, in case you missed it. But there's been no evidence whatsoever of active collusion yet between the Trump administration and the Russian government about the election. And in fact, Mike Flynn, right, who's now been indicted, he's pled guilty to lying to the FBI. What did he lie to the FBI about? Supposedly, he lied to the FBI, according to the charges themselves. He lied to the FBI about a call he made to the Russians during the transition period in which he asked them to back off of a resolution that was against Israel. That does not sound like Russian collusion to me. Russia, by the way, did not back off. That does not sound like Russian collusion to me. So maybe there's further evidence. Maybe it'll come out. Maybe it'll all come out in the wash. Maybe all of the rumors will end up being true. It won't just be smoke. It'll be fire. But one thing is eminently true and obviously true. There was actual evidence of serious criminal collusion between the Obama administration and the Russians, because it is criminal to back State Department stated terrorist groups because you want an Iran deal with a terrorist government, which is exactly what was happening here. And that's exactly what was happening here. Just astonishing. And speaking of collusion, Attorney General Jeff Sessions is now requesting more information on the Uranium One deal. So things may be about to get very hot for the old Obama officials. We'll give you all the updates. Ben Shapiro in for Glenn Beck. Okay, so this is breaking news. Attorney General Jeff Sessions apparently has ordered investigators at the Justice Department to ask FBI agents to explain all of the evidence they found in the Uranium One investigation. This is a report from Tom Winter, Pete Williams, and Ken Delanian at NBC News. Apparently, the interviews with FBI agents are part of the Justice Department's effort to fulfill a promise to an assistant attorney general made to Congress last month to examine whether a special counsel was warranted to look into what has become known as the Uranium One deal. Now, you remember all the details surrounding Uranium One. At issue is a 2010 transaction in which the Obama administration allowed the sale of a U.S. uranium mining facility to Russian state atomic energy company. Hillary was Secretary of State at the time. The State Department was one of the nine agencies that agreed to approve the deal. Now, a senior law enforcement official who was briefed on the initial FBI investigation told NBC News there were allegations of corruption surrounding the process under which the U.S. government approved the sale. No charges were filed, but as the New York Times reported in April 2015, some of the people associated with the deal contributed millions of dollars to the Clinton Foundation. And Bill Clinton was paid $500,000 for one speech in Moscow by a Russian investment bank with links to the transaction. Hillary says she had nothing to do with it. Of course, that is somewhat doubtful. That is somewhat doubtful. And there are a lot of people a few weeks back who are trying to undermine the suspicions about the Uranium One deal. And I did a bit of a summary over at my website, Daily Wire, talking about what exactly happened in the Uranium One story. So here is what was true about the Uranium One deal. Hey, there's a guy named Frank Giustra. Hey, Frank Giustra was the original owner of Uranium One. And people said, okay, well, he had divested by the time of the sale of Uranium One and its assets to Rosatom, the Russian Atomic Energy Agency. But here's what is true. Okay, Giustra owned a company called Eurasia. That was sold to Uranium One. Giustra then said he divested his personal stake in the company, but his shareholders still own 60% of the company, and there's no way to confirm the truth of his claim. In 2009 and 2010, Rosatom, which is Russia's atomic energy agency, was poised to buy a majority of the company. They were barred by law from exporting American uranium abroad, so it wasn't that Russia was going to buy the uranium, send it back to Russia, and then use it to make bombs to murder Americans or something. That was not really the concern. The real concern here was that Russia bought Uranium One because they actually didn't want the American assets. They bought Uranium One because Uranium One had assets in other countries that they could use to make nukes. In 2013, Russia bought the rest of Uranium One with the approval of the Committee on Foreign Investment in the United States, as well as the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission and Utah agencies. The CFIUS includes the State Department. Hillary said she had nothing to do with the greenlighting. So how much money actually flowed from Uranium One beneficiaries to the Clinton Foundation? Well, if you don't include Giustra, then about $4 million. If you include Giustra, it's $145 million. But this is all a little too simplistic. So in 2015, here's what the New York Times reported. The Uranium One acquisition actually began in 2005 while Giustra still owned the company. Bill Clinton flew with Giustra to Kazakhstan, where the two of them dined with the authoritarian president, a guy named Nursultan Nazarbayev. Clinton then handed the Kazakh president a propaganda coup. This is the New York Times, not me. When he expressed support for Mr. Nazarbayev's bid to head an international elections monitoring group, undercutting American foreign policy and criticism of Kazakhstan's poor human rights record by, among other people, Hillary Clinton. Within days of the visit, Giustra's fledgling company Eurasia signed a preliminary deal giving its stakes in three uranium mines controlled by Kazatomprom, which was the Kazakhstan official energy agency. Eurasia then in 2007 merged with Uranium One, a South African company with assets in Africa and Australia, in a $3.5 billion transaction. The new company kept the Uranium One name. It was controlled by Eurasia investors, including Ian Telfer, who is a Canadian who became chairman. Giustra says at that point he sold his stake. Soon Uranium One began to snap up companies with assets in the United States. In April 2007, it announced that it was going to purchase a uranium mill in Utah. Hey, the questions about Rosatom's control of uranium isn't really about the Russians crafting nukes, as I say. It's about shortages of uranium in the United States and us being dependent on foreign sources for that material. And again, about Rosatom purchasing nuclear material in Kazakhstan. And the Clintons were still involved at this time. They were involved past the sale. This is the point. It didn't end with Giustra selling Rosatom. I mean, selling Uranium One. The new head, Ian Telfer, he gave between $1.3 million and $5.6 million in contributions to the Clinton Foundation from a constellation of people with ties to Uranium One or Eurasia. Without the assets, the Kazakh mines, the Russians would have had no interest in the deal. Amid the influx of Uranium One connected money, Clinton was invited to speak in Moscow in June 2010, the same month Rosatom struck its deal for a majority stake in Uranium One. So the same month that Rosatom decided to buy Uranium One, Clinton spent time in Moscow and got $500,000 for it. It's not at all unclear that the Clintons were unrelated to Uranium One. So again, just more evidence that Democrats were perfectly willing to work with the Russians when they saw a way to benefit from it. Pretty amazing.